So my name's Phil Myers. I'm a nurse practitioner with Palliative Care.
Megan Walzik, also a nurse practitioner with Palliative Care.
And I'm Wendy, I'm a nurse practitioner with Palliative Care. I decided to join them. Lovely folks.
Yeah.
Can you hear, are you guys all ICU or Cards
B? Not us two, we're Cards
B.
Yeah. I'm Todd with CCU team.
I'm Todd, nurse practitioner.
I'm Ben, Cards B.
Catherine, CCU.
Vincent, Cards B.
Ben, CCU.
Yeah, so we're here today to talk to you guys a little bit about palliative care and how we see us working with some of you guys in the ICU setting. And so we're going to cover some basics. And did you guys got the articles? Mm-hmm. Right? Okay.
Do you want to put on the little microphone?
Sorry.
Yeah. Whoever's speaking.
Because you're recording.
So we can catch
on. So we basically divided the slides into two, and so I'll be talking about kind of the definition of palliative care and the narrative medicine model that we use. And then Megan will be talking about more specifically how we function in the cardiac ICU, and if we have time, we'll do a couple of case studies. And obviously, this is very casual, so anytime you guys have questions, comments, whatever, feel free to speak up. Advance it?
Yeah. I can be your advancer.
Thank you for being my assistant,
you're
Wendy. Yeah, so these are our objectives. We're going to talk a little bit about what palliative care means, go through the basics and kind of the outline of the consult, and then how we fit into this cardiac ICU, and we'll do some case studies. Thank you. So question for you guys, how do you introduce palliative care? Have you introduced palliative care? And if you haven't, how would you?
So I just introduce him as another member of the team, especially in chronic disease model. So kind of another part of our multidisciplinary team.
So kind of that idea of that we're kind of embedded with all the other care providers, right? Okay. Any other ideas?
I would say maybe a member of the team that helps to make decisions or define the goals of where we want to direct care.
Yeah, great. Yeah, those are all very good. One of the things that we have found is over the years is that patients and families really respond best to kind of a broader definition of palliative care. Because if they've ever heard of palliative care, many people associate it with end of life or hospice, that kind of thing. And so we're trying to really define ourselves in a different way than that we're here to support people all along the illness trajectory, wherever it may be. And it's not just about end of life. So when you have introduced palliative care, or when you think about introducing palliative care, what are some of the obstacles that come to mind?
Patient and family think you're giving up.
Giving up. That's very common, yeah. And some of that has to do with timing, right? Like, it's the subtext of the conversations are like, wow, we've really run out of options. You know,
that's called palliative care.
What's that?
That's called palliative care.
Or palliative care is one of the things that we need to consider now that we don't have anything else to offer, right? So
I would even add patients and families, but also your colleagues, the attendings that you're working with. But I think some of those same stigmas, you know, palliative care, you'll come across with them. So it's a lot of education.
Yeah. And so for us, in general, we really trying to get move the idea of the palliative care consult up earlier in the course of the disease rather than at the very end, because that just reinforces these negative stereotypes. The timing can be really tricky though, right? Depending on the individual situation. If somebody's critically ill, but it's a potentially survivable situation and they could be back to fully functional or nearly fully functional, then maybe palliative care is, you know, that's kind of a gray area to involve palliative care. When the outcome is uncertain, but everybody's hoping to get back to, you know, baseline in some sense. You'll see different definitions of palliative care. I think this one is really straightforward and functional, and basically focuses on this idea of improving quality of life for patients and families that are facing life-threatening illness, and that we actually go through, we have our own way of approaching it, that you know, we do an assessment, we come up with a treatment plan, and that we're trying to address physical, psychosocial, and spiritual existential issues as well. So kind of the whole gamut. Again, you know, depending on the context, in the cardiac ICU it's a little bit different, because, you know, there's so much emphasis on the immediate needs, physiologic needs of the patient, that we don't get as actively involved in symptom management as we would in other settings, such as outpatient oncology, for example. The majority of palliative care programs are outpatient focused, and a lot of them, that's what they do, is symptom management. A lot of places don't have specialized pain services, and palliative care will do complex pain management. So this is just to, you know, give you an idea of that there are different trajectories depending on the illness, and you know, cancer being sort of archetypal for this idea that you can have pretty high function for a long time, and then you know, at some point, for many people, unfortunately, you know, you kind of hit the end of the line in terms of treatment, and then you have a fairly precipitous downward trajectory. And then this other kind of the middle path is organ failure, where you have kinds of improvements and you have, you know, setbacks, but the overall trajectory is kind of down. Chronic illness of various kinds, such as heart failure, COPD. And then the bottom line is, you know, typically seen in the frail elderly, where you have kind of a, you know, you can have improvement and decline, but generally it's pretty downhill, and that the baseline level of function is pretty low to begin with. And then this was kind of an interesting slide. It's like, this is heart failure, which is pretty much all over the map. Very hard to predict, and that adds an element, you know, another challenging element to the work that we do, to try to prognosticate how a particular patient's going to do. And this is just to highlight the kind of the traditional way of looking at medical treatment. So you have, you know, aggressive treatment, and then at some point, okay, we're done. We don't have anything else to offer. Now it's time for hospice. Okay, and we're trying to slowly move towards this idea that, you know, palliative care can be useful earlier in the course of the disease, and while the patient is still receiving potentially curative treatment, but definitely life prolonging treatment, and then at some point will be hospice appropriate, end of life, et cetera. And also the idea that, you know, the the work continues even after the death of the patient. So this idea that we continue to support the family in bereavement. And we do have a fairly robust bereavement program, and Carol, our social worker, is really that's one of her main areas. So goals of palliative care, to support good communication between all members of the healthcare team, patients and families, expert management of pain and other symptoms, sometimes we are that continuity piece for patients and families, so that, you know, they're in and out of the ICU, they're on different services potentially, and we can be that, can help them kind of navigate through that. Support for complex medical decision making, emotional and spiritual support, and then of course, as I mentioned already, you know, really focusing on trying to maximize quality of life, and even though they're very ill. So this slide is kind of expands that idea of quality of life a little bit more, to talk about the physical, psychological.
Do you want me to put them all
up? Yeah, just put them all on the social and spiritual domains. And you know, quality of life is, you know, highly subjective as a phrase. It can mean so many different things to different people at different times, you know, changes. And so just to keep in mind that, you know, it can really touch on all these different areas of the patient and family's life. obviously, you know, symptom management, pain, a lot of the issues that we deal with on a day-to-day basis in the ICU. And then, you know, not to be overlooked, you know, we see this a lot, you know, the spouse or the family member who doesn't have a lot of resources, is camping out in the ICU, sleeping in the room, that sort of thing. And kind of stepping back from that, you know, just people who are dealing with a loved one who has a chronic illness, I mean, there's significant caregiver burden associated with that, we know. The change in their roles and relationships, of course, their body image or sexual function that we rarely deal with. And of course, all the psychological things that we see that have a huge impact on their ability to cope with their ICU stay and make progress. And then lastly, but not leastly, the spiritual dimension, existential dimension, that all of this is plays into and feeds off each other. There are, you know, many people who feel kind of isolated existentially in the ICU setting in particular, and really struggle with trying to keep their bearings psychologically, as well as kind of make meaning out of the situation that they're in, especially when there's a lot of uncertainty.
And we'll talk later about kind of what our team looks like, but we're actually now a very interdisciplinary team, and that's really been as of the last 8 months. We have a chaplain on our team now, a full-time chaplain, and then we will have two social workers. So there's, I think, within our team an ability to address a lot of the different aspects.
I did that by itself.
Oh, it did?
I know.
Oh, nice. Yeah. So this kind of goes back to the idea of, you know, introducing palliative care in a very general way. There's actually some research that shows that people respond to this idea of an extra layer of support, right? The way that we do that is the way that we get at the issue of what constitutes quality of life for that particular patient and family is to invite them into a conversation about what's important to them, what are they hoping for, what are they worried about, and then kind of giving voice to those priorities and those goals, and having it inform the medical decisions that are made all along the way. So just some basic ideas around narrative medicine. So story is really the way that we all make sense of our lives. And that doesn't change when you enter the medical system. And it's really important for us to understand where the patient and family are coming from, because that's how we get an idea of how they make meaning out of the medical care that they're getting and the illness that they're dealing with. And most importantly, you know, we're there to help edit their stories, but not rewrite them or write them for them, right?
Sorry.
No, it's okay. And then, you know, just to talk a little bit about the distinction between primary and specialty palliative care services. So primary palliative care really addresses kind of the very basic skills and competencies that we should all have as medical providers to have these conversations about, you know, what does this mean to you, you know, the goals of care discussion, that comes up often, right? And then getting into a more specialized palliative care. So when you have challenging families, patient doesn't want to talk about end of life or the possibility that they may die. There's disagreement in the family. There's disagreement among team members. All those kinds of things are when, you know, it might be helpful to have somebody who's has some specialized training in palliative care.
That's sort of, we're sort of seeing as secondary palliative care.
Yeah, yeah. And then tertiary palliative care just means, I've actually never seen it
quite
that way.
Well, this is like Hillian Starks.
Yeah, yeah.
That, like, does research to sort of quantify what the service brings to the
center. Yeah. And I think, you know, tertiary really, in my mind, means that in addition to the clinical services that we provide, we also have a focus on teaching and research as well.
I have a question. How comfortable do you guys feel at doing sort of primary palliative care? Do you do it in your practice before you came here, or is that a new term for you?
I think it's this idea that, you know, when we work with the oncology services and the different ICU services, the BMT Onc ICU, and that you guys are doing this every day. You're assessing their understanding of the situation, you're educating, you're talking about goals. And so I think to really sort of acknowledge that that is part of your work. You don't have an hour to sit down and get the full story. And so that really is what our role is as the palliative care, you know, specialist, is to get, you know, more detail, more information to be able to bring that to you guys. So,
yeah.
I'm very uncomfortable with when a patient has unrealistic expectations of their longevity.
Mm-hmm.
And so I became accustomed to turfing it to the attendant who had a relationship with them. Yeah.
What is it about that makes you feel uncomfortable?
Because they, you know, like I said, not so much with patients that understand, look, I, you know, this is, I'm nearing my end.
Yeah.
It was the young, actually not always young.
Yeah.
People that just thought that there would be more. Well, transfer me down to the University
right.
of Washington. They will save me. And
right.
I don't know why I'm just.
I think that like really brings up like a really important point, is that like there's different things that we see in patients that trigger certain parts of ourselves that make it harder to talk about these things too. and it's like different, like oncology patients for me, some like I have a really hard time with, you know, but I can do the end stage liver patient. Like it's just,
so
and I think part of it is the culture that we live in too. We are in a very death denying culture.
Yeah.
In our society, and talking about the possibility of things not working can be hard, especially if the patient's really holding on to that.
Is that an appropriate referral or appropriate use of, I mean?
It is, and I think
sure.
Also, you know, Phil will sort of talk about what our consult looks like in a narrative way, and that the first step is finding out where they are. And then there's language that you can use, and that's things like asking permission. Would it be okay if I shared with you some of our concerns? How much information in detail do you want to hear about your illness and about your prognosis? Would it be okay if we talked about your prognosis? And I think there's language that you can use that is inviting them to engage and be open to hearing. It doesn't mean that they're going to get to where you want them to be right away, but it's a step-by-step process. And those kind of patients, you don't usually get all the way where you want to be in that first discussion. But those warning shots, those were really concerned. Would it be okay if we talked about this? You know, those are kind of the initial things that you can, the initial language that you can use. And Phil will talk more about, you know, how we integrate that.
Yeah.
But that's a really good point, especially being in this
mm-hmm.
academic medical center where people
where
are like,
come.
I'm here because nobody else could do anything.
Me.
Yeah. So they expect you to be able to do things that nobody else could do. So
yeah.
And you know, we feed into that obviously as a place, you know, as our own culture in at UW Medical Center, you know, where you know, whether we say it or not in our marketing, we say, you know, miracles happen here. We save people who are on the brink of death. And of course, you know, so medical providers in the community as well as patients and families are like, gotta get to the U. Everybody's given up on me. They're saying there's nothing, there's no hope. So, you know, there's sort of a self-selected, semi-self, you know, and they're not choosing to come here obviously, but they're so sick, there's really nowhere else for them to go. And and so you have, you know, very high expectations among these families from the get-go, right?
Yeah.
So you're working uphill against that, right? And then trying to bring some sense of reality, you know, it's like, guess what? We don't have a doodad that can fix your particular problem,
doodad.
Right? You know, I just read New York Times, you know, you guys are supposed to be like, you know, implementing this new technology and you've got all these fancy medications. What do you mean you can't fix me? That kind of thing. So, so I think, you know, definitely, you know, calling palliative care, and even if we don't necessarily get an open door to do a consult, I think just curbsiding us and kind of talking through the case can be helpful sometimes. Because we really do want to have the permission of the patient and or family to come in and sit down with them. And not, you know, I often say that when I introduce myself, you know, you don't have to talk to us if you don't want to. We're really here to try to support you better. And but those expectations can be very dug in,
mm-hmm.
right? And I think a lot of times we just have to deal with our impatience because we all want things to move faster, right? Oh my God, it's 14 days in the ICU and there hasn't, you know, we all know where this is going, or we think we do, and the, you know, the family's not moving at all. And so it's really about kind of like slowly building relationship, building rapport, trying to understand their narrative as best you can. And asking those questions again, you know, what are you hoping for now? How do you see your situation? What's kind of bottom line quality of life? How many times have we seen patients who have an advanced directive, if they have an advanced directive, say, I wouldn't want to be dependent on life support. I don't want to be a vegetable. And then they're 2 months in the ICU. It's like, what does that mean? You know, you have this document that says you wouldn't want to be dependent on life support, but here you are. So it's, you know, having a document is one thing, but then when the rubber hits the road, it's a little bit different. Yeah, so this is just to give the idea that we want to be in a listening mode more than a talking mode, evoking the patient's story and then responding in a way that really communicates that we're listening deeply to what they're saying to us. So, you know, the outline of the consult that we do really is quite simple. It's not necessarily the easiest to do, but we want to get an idea of what they know about their disease, their situation, what they want to know, because sometimes that's an important factor. And then ask everybody who is there, you know, not just the patient, but the family member, because the family member may know a lot that they haven't really shared with the patient, and there might be a reason for that. You know, they're trying to protect them or whatever. And hopefully you get those, you pick up on that right away, and you might ask permission of the patient, would you like us to speak with your loved one outside the room, and then we'll come back and give you a summary, or we'll let the family member interpret. And that gets pretty tricky. You know, a lot of people might have an ethical issue with that. This idea that, you know, you're not being fully transparent with the patient. But there are lots of cultures that we deal with, and not just people from other cultures, but this idea that, you know, we don't want to undermine the patient's hope. And if we tell them everything, then they're going to lose hope. That's very common. So, and then, you know, ask them to tell me what are you hoping for? I've heard people use that phrase. If you could wave a magic wand right now, what would that look like? What would your life look like? And then, what are you worried about? You know. When I first started doing palliative care, we asked people, tell me what you're most afraid of. What are you scared of? And I really have gotten away from that, because to me, it's a little provocative to ask about fears. You know, that seems like it's going a little too quickly into some dicey areas, you know, that they may not be ready to go into. So I think talking about worries or concerns is more palatable. And then identifying strengths. So when you've dealt with adversity in the past, what has helped you get through that? You know, what was it like to care for your mom when she was dealing with cancer? Have you ever cared for somebody on hospice? Do you know what hospice is? That kind of thing. And of course, this is the place where you might ask about spiritual beliefs, inclinations, practices, that sort of thing. I guess I went out of order in that
one. It's all
good. Yeah, it's okay. So, you know, same idea. So what are your communication preferences? What do you know? What do you want to know? And this is often the place where we'll ask about how communication is between the patient and family and the team. Like, are you getting all the information that you need, that you want? How are things? Are you hearing different things from different teams? Sometimes that's an issue, right? There may be different opinions, depending on renal says this, pulmonary says this, cardiology says this. Like, how is that? I'm totally confused, right? And then, you know, what do they need to know? That's another issue sometimes. What's kind of the, you know, if I'm kind of a gestalt person, I don't need to know all the details, but what do I really need to know in order to make good decisions for myself? And then, so what we do is we kind of gather all that, what can be, you know, kind of amorphous information out of those conversations, and then try to put together, you know, identify the themes that are speaking to us in from what they say, and then put together some recommendations that really take into account that story. Yeah, so do you guys have any questions at this point? Does that all make sense? Okay, good.
Do you have anything to add about sort of the narrative piece?
I was just curious, has anyone ever heard of narrative medicine? Mm-hmm.
No?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, Stu Farber, for those of you that knew Stu Farber, you know, he started the palliative care program here, and narrative medicine was really his thing. And so, like Phil said, other programs tend to be, you know, every program, even within Seattle at the VA, at Providence, at Swedish, have slightly different approaches to their palliative care programs. But our approach with narrative medicine really comes from Stu. And
I think the thought is that we're really good at medical care, which is totally essential, but it's also completely essential that we know the story that fits with the right medical care for them, because if they're both not aligned, then we don't have a good plan to go ahead. So it's really just good planning. But it just, and it takes a lot of time. I think the listening piece is really the biggest piece of going in instead of the ask and actually listen, which we all, I know, try to do. But it's busy.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the sort of who our team is and sort of practical aspects of how you ask us to get involved. And then we're going to get into ICU. So here's a picture of our team. We have expanded a ton. I think Phil has been here for about 4 years, five. And then I've been here for 3 years, but you know, several years ago it was really just us and maybe one attending. And then Wendy joined us full time. So the folks on the top are all of our full time providers. We have a medical director, associate director, and then we have two full time physicians, three full time nurse practitioners, full time social worker, chaplain, and then we are interviewing for another social worker. The providers on the bottom of the slide are part-time folks, and they do anywhere from 4 to 6 or 8 weeks of call a year. A couple people that you will probably run into the most would be Stephanie Cooper, who's a cardiologist and also board certified in palliative care, did her fellowship in palliative care here, is one of our part-time attendings. Becca is a part-time nurse practitioner with us, and then Sharon is the outpatient palliative care nurse who works with Stephanie, so in the Regional Heart Center. So our service is a consult service. We have attendings on call, and we have 24/7 call coverage. We have somebody in-house 6 days a week. Sometimes we have somebody on Sunday, but not always. There are some weekends where we are kind of phone coverage on Sunday. We are always consulted by the primary team. So nurses will sometimes call us, which is okay, but we have to circle back and have the consult come from directly from you guys and from your service. The reasons, you know, why you may consult us, goals of care discussions, pain and symptom management, although as Phil mentioned, we do a lot more of that in other areas of the hospital, particularly with our oncology patients. We do less of that in the ICU because you guys do a great job. Help with communication and with complex medical decision making, and that's really done in the context of getting that story and then building relationships. So we may do the initial consult and then, you know, carry on and maybe do family meetings with you guys, and those decisions kind of happen a long time. Advanced care planning, a lot of patient and family-centered support. I'd say that's a lot of what we do in the ICU, and then ethically complex situations. We can be consulted at any point. I'd say, in general, it's nice if we get consults
a little bit earlier. We used to get, you know, lots of sort of 24 hours within, you know, patients dying, and there's not a lot that we can do. I mean, we can help sometimes, but we're pretty limited when we haven't even met the family before. So, you know, even if we're all hoping for a good outcome, if you're, you know, if there's a lot of uncertainty about where things are going to be going, we encourage you to get us on board earlier so that we can actually develop a relationship with the families. And just page us through the paging operator. We're also walking through the unit all the time, and you can give any of us a new consult at any point. So.
Do you want that up?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
So palliative care in the cardiac ICU, and we're gonna sort of talk about, you know, advanced heart failure as well, sort of 5 Northeast, 5 Southeast. The cultures are different in every, with every service, every patient population, and I think that we're used to that. We're used to working with different personalities, different services. I think some of the unique aspects of the cardiac ICU culture, one is your stakeholders, so your cardiologists, your cardiac surgeons, the MCS team. Cardiologists have had long relationships with these patients. There's a lot of different vested interest in how things are going and what the outcomes are. A lot of your patients have had surgery. They're in the post-operative kind of recovery period. They may have complications following surgery. Still uncertain outcomes, but again, people are still very vested in the recovery from that, whatever that surgical process was. Other things that I kind of think of with the cardiac ICU, and this is actually similar to other patient populations as well, but you have patients who are coming from all over the region, and they're airlifted here from Alaska and, you know, from Idaho, and they're coming from outside hospitals, and the families are in crisis. They've left their community, their support. They may have no belongings with them. They may have no place to sleep. They may have a brand new diagnosis. They may be here because, you know, as you were mentioning, nobody can do anything for them anywhere else. And so there's, you know, this sort of desperation. And so I think that is a unique challenge with what we deal with here, you know, really all over the medical center, because we see this with transplant patients and SCCA patients as well. We, you know, we're in a consulting role, so our customer is you guys and your team, and we're there to support the patient and the family, but, you know, just to really emphasize that we're there to partner with you guys. And Todd, what you mentioned about introducing us as part of the team, like, that goes a really long ways. So when you're talking about getting palliative care involved, or when we go and introduce ourselves, really emphasizing that we are, you know, that we're all working together and that we're all part of their care team. And I think that normalizes our involvement for everybody, you know, everybody involved. And then the other thing is sort of transitions of care, that patients are often, you know, prolonged hospitalizations, back and forth between 5 Southeast, 5 Northeast, maybe going out, you know, into the community, following up with cardiologists, and then coming, you know, being readmitted for, you know, frequent hospitalizations. So a lot of what we end up doing is connecting people with resources outside of the hospital, whether that's outpatient palliative care at Regional Heart Center, whether that's an outpatient palliative care program with home visits, whether that's hospice, whether that's call us if they come back into the hospital, because we'd like to have that, you know, sort of continuity. So lots of different ways that those transitions can be smoothened, I think, when we're sort of in the loop.
One of the things we worked a lot with the palliative care teams, heart being one of the problems was with the transition. So patients, mm-hmm. you know, patients are admitted, and then, you know, then they go back to their primary care or their chronic disease specialist, whatever that is.
Yeah.
Would you automatically make them an outpatient palliative care appointment since you've been seeing them in the hospital, or do you wait for the outpatient provider to re-refer them to the outpatient palliative care clinic?
So ideally, the outpatient palliative care clinic at the regional heart center is supposed, if they're going to be followed, which most of the patients here are followed in the clinic here, is that correct?
Well, I'd say it's mostly here. So the only outpatient palliative care program, we don't have a program like Harborview does here. Our only outpatient palliative care providers are two part-time, you know, Stephanie and Sharon. And so, and they're pretty limited to the LVAD patients right now. They'll do some other patients, but is that kind of what you're...
Well, I mean, it doesn't have to be cardiac patients. It could be like end-stage liver disease or somebody with, I mean, it's just somebody who's, you know, because I think a lot of things, we do a lot of things in the hospital that we don't ever transition that to the... Mm-hmm. So then they come back to the hospital.
I would say the best transition that is seamless here at UW is between the oncology patients and there's a SCCA outpatient palliative care program, and that makes a huge difference. We have a patient right now that was seen for 2 months outpatient palliative care at SCCA. Is here, we have like so much narrative on her, what she wants, and it's made us being able to help her more. So, and then when she goes back out, we can just refer her back. So I would say there is a huge gap.
There aren't
sometimes
a lot of...
Sometimes we try, Northwest has an outpatient palliative care program, Northwest Hospital. Daryl Owens is running that. They're pretty specific in who they can and cannot take, especially if they go to a skilled nursing facility, they can't follow them there. So that is limitation. But yeah, no, it's a challenge.
Well, and just from a resource standpoint, Harborview, I think, historically has kind of taken on the role of primary care provider in the context of palliative care, but they don't have that many providers, so you know they have to be kind of selective. But we do facilitate those referrals sometimes to Harborview.
So types of patients, cardiac patients that we're involved in. We are supposed to see, and I think we generally do, see every patient who is admitted for advanced heart failure therapy workup. So sometimes they end up not being a candidate for any advanced therapies. Sometimes they'll end up being LVAD patients or TAH patients, LVAD as DT or BTT or sort of all combinations. Sometimes they'll end up getting medically managed and being discharged. But we are part of the consult order set, whatever, for all those patients.
And just a comment about that, about the LVAD patients. So probably the majority of those pre-LVAD patients that we see are kind of a one-and-done consults. If, you know, it's a checkbox, basically, for Part B. And if we don't see any kind of red flags that say that, you know, there's going to be potential problems down the road, we'll kind of sign off on them and say to the team, call us if there's an issue down the road. And then there's others that are, you know, clearly it's more complicated, and we'll keep following them.
So other types of patients, transplant patients with complications, patients who aren't candidates for advanced heart failure therapies, and then congenital heart disease, TAVR. I think the TAVRs, we've gone through waves of seeing those folks. They're generally pretty fragile patients. And then advanced CAD and PVD. So just to, this was actually one of Stephanie's slides. And just to sort of show that, you know, the heart failure patients, their experiences can often, at end of life, can often, well, is often very medicalized. Part of that is the challenge with prognostication and this sort of, you know, we never know, is this the turning point hospitalization, or, you know, for somebody who's sort of in and out. And but, you know, greater than 80% hospitalized in the last 6 months, 50% with an ICU admission, 20% with invasive procedures, a large majority dying in ICU, many with CPR, and then a study, I guess, done a while ago, but, you know, only a third of the family members knew they had a poor prognosis. So obviously more work done needs to be done kind of in the outpatient setting before they get here, but also just being in tune to having these conversations when people are able to have them. So again, you know, early, which early for us is often quite late, actually. you know, yeah, people have had their diagnosis of their heart failure for a while. They have an EF of, you know, 10%, and now we're talking about prognosis and advanced care planning. So doing it at a time when they're able to participate, when you can have these discussions with their family members there, when you can ask, you know, gosh, we hope you can always make decisions for yourself, but if something happens and you can't make your own decisions, who's going to make them for you? And then you pull all those people together in the same room and you talk about, you know, what Phil went through. What do you understand? What, you know, what has the team shared with you? Would it be okay to share and talk about the concerns that we have and to, you know, talk about hoping for the best and also planning, you know, for what if that doesn't happen and what would your goals be? And those conversations should be readdressed. You know, it's not, these aren't the one and done, you know, consults or discussions. When people, you know, are coming back in ICU, they're leaving, you know, discharged, they come back into the hospital. These things need to be readdressed because people's situations change and their hopes change. And so making sure that we're continuing to touch base. Symptom burden is very high. High level of distress and anxiety in caregivers, and so a lot of our work is not just in supporting the patient, but also supporting the family through, you know, a lot of changes and losses along the way. So, and this just illustrates, you know, that while many patients are hoping for every possible additional day, you know, of longevity, that the quality of life is equally is often equally as important for them, and so that's why you need to have those discussions about what is important. One of the things, you know, that especially here, that you know, we're doing more and more LVADs, we're doing more and more you know, seeing more and more of the total artificial hearts. There's more technology, and with those, you know, devices comes a lot of challenges, particularly at end of life. And so transitions and end of life planning and, you know, changes, you know, when patients are transitioned to comfort care, there are a lot of opportunities for, I think, doing a better job and sort of learning about, you know, how to support staff and how to support families and how to sort of come together as a team and really make that transition as good as it can be. I think, you know, one of the things we're seeing on 5 Northeast is that, you know, the ICUs, the nurses have a lot of experience with things like ventilator withdrawal and you know, discontinuation of kind of life prolonging treatments, but there's something that feels different about, you know, turning an LVAD off or turning a total artificial heart off. And, you know, I think that's something that, you know, will be part of a unique sort of challenge and opportunity for you guys as well, because that's going to be part of your work and part of your work with the staff on the floor. So,
okay. When somebody decides, yeah, they want to be on palliative care, at least where I worked, that meant we turned their ICD off.
No. So
this is different.
Yeah. So what Phil showed at early on of the integration with palliative care and the rest of their treatment, whatever their treatment looks like.
Yeah.
So yeah, and when families ask that, oh, what am I signing up for? What am I going on palliative care? Like, that's not how we approach it at all.
Yeah.
That's definitely
so
not.
So that's how palliative care is explained. How is palliative care explained in your institution?
Yeah, it's if you're going to be a palliative care patient, they turn their ICD off, they withdraw a lot of support, and the goal is, you know, home or
Was this like an inpatient unit, like an inpatient palliative care unit, or?
No, this was, did you have that experience as well?
Well, I think there's, they still incorporate, it's not just end of life, I don't think, but sometimes if we consulted palliative, or whatever, prop too.
Okay, basically. So this is Prov Everett, or? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Sometimes if we had them consult and the patient was going toward the direction of end of life and doing less, then sometimes palliative care would take over as the primary service and arrange for the patient to go home, arrange for hospice. That's what you're talking about, right?
Yeah, except that we didn't, I mean, as far as I was concerned, we didn't consult unless it was crystal clear.
That's what it tends to
happen. Yeah.
And I think that's sort of like what we're talking about in this discussion,
And that's why you get consulted so late, because it's not...
Well, it's presented as, like, you know, here's your options, palliative care being one of them. You know, we can try this last-ditch effort drug, or you can get palliative care.
Which one do you want?
So I mean, it's really, it's just a, it's really an issue of, you know, how you're using the term and what you mean by it. And so what I'm hearing is, you know, that's what we call comfort care, which doesn't necessarily mean that we get involved, so there might not be a palliative care patient.
Mm-hmm.
It really depends on the context.
Sometimes the best palliative care is 100% full speed forward and getting someone with fulminant heart failure to transplant and they walk out of here. I mean, so there, and we'll go through a few case studies, but
sometimes we advocate for people going on TPN or all kinds of things.
Yeah. So it all depends. Yeah, it all depends on the patient's situation. And so just a few case studies, and there's lots of examples, but this was a patient a year and a half ago, a couple years ago. Carrie probably remembers him, maybe. So a 62-year-old who was admitted with a brand new diagnosis of cardiomyopathy, urgently worked up for advanced heart failure therapies. I think he had maybe biventricular failure. We were consulted early, kind of learned a little bit about who he was. Postal worker, very active, extremely active. And his goal was to have more quality time with his wife, and he had a high threshold for acceptable quality of life. He ended up getting a TAH and it's good. He had a pretty long hospital course. He was here for a few months. He was back and forth between 5 Northeast and 5 Southeast, kind of off and on, status 7, you know, actively listed for transplant. And we provided support to his wife. He was having recurrent thrombus. He ended up having a large stroke and was unresponsive, and he was transitioned to comfort care. And it was really helpful that we were involved early, before he even got his total artificial heart. We had a lot of interdisciplinary family meetings to talk about where things were and what would be needed, what would need to happen in order to get to transplant, and providing support. And at that time, I really don't think we had had, I mean, we still haven't had a lot of experience, maybe Carrie knows, with turning off the total artificial hearts. But I mean, I think maybe we'd only done it a couple times or so at this point. It was pretty limited.
It's infrequent enough that we always have to find the instructions. And
So I actually wasn't there when they turned it off. He had some flash pulmonary edema. And overall, I think things went well. And his wife, who was lovely, said that she felt like his soul had left his body hours before. Just some key points of working with that family. This was another patient on 5 Southeast who, 66-year-old with ischemic cardiomyopathy, also was being worked up for advanced heart failure therapies because of his renal function, was not really a candidate. and he was on a balloon pump and dobutamine, and his wife had a lot of experience in, so she had, I think, been a cardiac ICU nurse and was very articulate and knowledgeable, and multiple meetings over the course of a number of days, and then ultimately decision was made to transition to comfort care. One of the interesting things about this case was that, and I've seen things go lots of different ways, but he, you know, they stopped dialysis, they stopped his dobutamine, they left the balloon pump in, and she told me later that she kind of perceived this as prolonging his death. But I've also seen cases where it was turned off, but that it was left in, and patients didn't die. And so I think there's just sort of being really thoughtful about having discussions around what makes sense in this situation, and being really thoughtful and planning is important, and making sure that the nurse is involved and that everybody kind of knows what to expect and what the steps are.
I would say that, you know, a couple of times I've seen problems when going into a weekend and the
handoff
are,
or,
it's going to be a different attending, mm-hmm. and sometimes it's not crystal clear what the plan is for how we're going to do this.
Yes.
That can become an issue.
Yeah, yeah. And then I'll go through really, actually, Phil can go through the last case of sort of ending on a, a different.
Happy note.
Yeah.
I knew this case quite well. So, young woman with congenital heart failure and very active. She had four kids. She worked for the school district, I think, as a landscaper. And she ended up with, you know, exacerbation, ECLS was when we were called. It looked pretty dire and kind of a hour-to-hour thing, day-to-day. And then eventually she stabilized, and she got a TAH at some point and did really well with that, was able to go home with the, what do we call it, the Freedom Driver. And then ultimately got a transplant and is doing really well as far as I know. So the point of all of that is that, you know, we actually had a positive outcome. Patient didn't die. And we were there all along the way. It could have gone the other way, of course, but you know, we do have those cases where there's a patient got what they were hoping for, and we celebrate with them. So, any questions, comments, concerns? One thing that I would say is that it's very helpful, even though you guys are extremely busy. It's very helpful to have, even if you come into a family meeting and you say, I can only be here for 10 minutes or 15 minutes, there's often medical issues or medical questions that get asked, and having you there, get a lot of mileage out of that typically, as opposed to just us.
And I also would encourage you guys, especially during your orientation before things really get going, to feel free to join us for a consult. I mean, whether it's an ICU patient or, you know, a heart failure or an oncology, and just to kind of see what our consult looks like. Because it sounds like it's really different maybe than what you've experienced elsewhere. And
it may not be so different, but as far as we were in different groups, my group. But.
Yeah, yeah. Because I think when you sort of see what it looks like, it's very different than what a lot of people imagine. And one of the ways that, you know, that I'll often introduce it is, you know, that we're so focused on the medical aspects of your care, on what your creatinine is or what your EF is or, you know, what your chest x-ray shows or whatever, that it's really important that we hear about your story. Because who you are and what's important to you and your family is really, really important in how we, you know, can give you the best possible care. And people usually respond really well to that. You know, it's like, oh, I get to talk about, you know, I get to talk about my, because, you know, it's.
And sometimes they don't.
Yeah, sometimes they don't, but most of the time.
Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they're like,
Yeah.
I want to talk to you. But that's pretty. That's life, right?
Yeah. And I'd say that's pretty rare. I mean, for the most part.
Yeah, but, usually people totally want to talk. But I'm just saying, like,
yeah,
just like when you go to talk to any patient about things, you get different reactions.
And then,
thank you.
Yeah, we did have, there's one last slide, and it's, for those of you that knew Stu or don't, who was our director and passed away earlier this year, and wrote this poem about his experience. My heart is full of good intentions. I want to help using all I know. I know a lot you don't know about diagnosis, treatment, risks, benefits, statistics. How can I assure you know enough so you can make the right choices? I protect my heart so I am safe from making choices, from sharing your life. My heart is full of life. I know a lot you don't know about love, hope, grief, fear, illness, mortality. How can I help you know enough about who I am so you can help me make the right choices, so we can share our knowledge and our lives? So, let's do.
Thank you.